All right, everyone, welcome to the Anthill Inside Science Fiction Book Club. We are here today with Lavanya Lakshminarayan, and we're staying ahead of the curve talking about her book, Analog Virtual. Right? Few things before we begin. Please keep your mics on mute. We will be taking questions at the end of the session. So please keep typing them into the chat box as and when they occur to you. To introduce myself, I am Vijayalakshmi. I am the author of Strangely Familiar Tales. My writing, my poetry and short stories have been published in various online journals and anthologies. And my writing on pop culture and feminism can also be found on Women's Web. My co-moderator today is the wonderful T.G. Shenoy. T.G. Shenoy is an SFF enthusiast and columnist and critic. He is the writer of India's longest running weekly SF column, New Worlds Weekly for Factor Daily, and the Specfix column for Bangalore Mirror. He also curates the SF track for Bangalore Lit Fest. He has featured in podcasts such as the Talaharate Kannada podcast and events such as the Sri Lanka Comic Con to talk about SFF in general and Indian SF in particular. He hosts To Boldly Go, a fun SFF quiz every Saturday. He is also an advertising and marketing professional and is currently a consulting partner with Celsius 100 Consulting. Today, of course, we're speaking to Lavanya Lakshminarayan, whose book Analog Virtual has been in the news recently for all the writers. Welcome, Lavanya, and congratulations. Lavanya Lakshminarayan is the Locus and BSFA Award-nominated author of Analog Virtual and Other Simulations of Your Future. She recently won the Times of India Author Award for Best Debut Novel. She's also a game designer, has built worlds for Zynga Inc.'s Farmville 2 and Mafia Wars, dabbled in building games around NFTs on blockchain, and attempt to design an augmented reality robot fighting game. Her forthcoming publications include a short story in the Golink's book of South Asian Science Fiction, Volume 2, and her novelette in the anthology Third Eye. In her spare time, Lavanya is a classically trained pianist with stage fright, an animal lover with two dogs, and a world traveler who can't wait for her next big adventure. Lavanya can be found on Instagram at lavanya.ln and on Twitter at lavanya_ln. Shenoy, would you like to get us started off by telling us why Analog Virtual is such an essential book for our times?
This is the book, and I absolutely loved it when I read it first. So like all good SF, whether you're talking about future or whether you're talking about new governances, ultimately speaks to its time. And I thought in that sense, Analog Virtual and Other Simulations of Your Future was very timely and very relevant, you know, sort of holding a mirror to where we are and where we should not go, right? That I think is more important. For those of you who've not read the book, this contains about 20 stories and is set in the future where states no longer exist as we know it. And all cities have been privatized, run by corporations. Those that are not privatized are run as a cooperative society, but they're very few and far in between. The most successful cities, like Apex City, is run by corporations such as the Bell Corp. Now, Apex City is what once upon a time used to be called Bangalore. And the title Analog Virtual refers to the people who live in Apex City. The virtuals are your elite, who have access to technology and who live by the mantra of productivity and success. Whereas the analogs are the ones who don't meet Bell Corp's, standards of productivity and everything, and are thus relegated to outside Apex City, where with no access to water, electricity, and all of those things. And if you are even worse than that, you get sent off to the vegetable farms. I guess you can figure out what the vegetable farms are, where you are the vegetable and you get farmed. And for those familiar with Bangalore, the dividing line between the analogs and the virtual is the Carnatic Meridian, which lies at Mint Square, which is where the Kavan Park Metro Station is right now, where the Tejas jet has been kept. And that's the dividing line between these two worlds. Now, as much as we talk about meritocracy and all of those things, the world that Lavanya has posited in analog virtual isn't something to look forward to. Because everybody's life is governed by the bell curve. You know, just it's almost like I keep saying, like an annual appraisal by HR. Right. That's the vision of the future that's there in analog virtual, and we see snippets of it through 20 short stories, interlinked short stories about various people and what life is within and without. Life is as an analog or as a virtual, or virtuals who want to slip into analogism and analogs trying to be virtual. And we'll discuss about these themes in great detail as we come along. But before we proceed, would like to really congratulate you, Lavanya. Your debut novel, longlisted for the Nebulas, SFW's Nebulas. It was there on the Locus recommended list for 2020. And that's quite the feat. We had the maximum representation from Indian authors this year in the Locus, and yours was amongst the best there. You just won the author award for best debut 2020. So how does it feel like that people are buying into your dystopian vision, or what's it been like, the journey so far?
It's kind of surreal, Shanoy, and you know, thank you and Vijaya for having me here and for saying such wonderful things about my book, about Analog Virtual. It's incredible to have it received this way, simply because when you write your book and you send it out there, at least for me personally, I hope it just connects with, you know, one person, right? Like I just want one other person to read it and say, I got what you were trying to say. So to have such a diverse spectrum of people recognize it and appreciate it, not just here at home in India, but also outside of India, I think it's really quite overwhelming, and it's very heartening to know. It means that the concerns that I chose to write about, because I was writing from a point of concern, these are concerns that we are sharing together as humanity. And that is really the biggest takeaway for me from all of this recognition that the book has received of late.
Coming to how Analog Virtual is structured, it's 20 interlinked stories which puts the focus, and each of them talks about different bits. So there's this one story about monsters under the bed, which is probably my favorite of the lot, also the scariest of the lot, where this person has this implant which tells him what to think, what not to think, so that he comes in line with Belkov's vision. Then you have POV characters from the resistance, you know, from the underground, and all of that. And I think I agree with Yen Mon when he wrote in Locus that this must be the sort of format for future dystopian books. Right, instead of, because and when I read that, I was reminded of what Tolstoy said, you know, all happy families are the same, but every that family is sad in its own different way. So 20 visions of sadness, each different, makes perfect sense for a dystopia rather than for a utopia where you can just have one character see his or her life through. So I mean, what was the decision to structure it like this, and what was it easy, what was it difficult? And I know it's a publishing thing, but when we were nominating and voting on for the Locus, we were like trying to figure out, okay, do we slot this into a collection or do we slot this into a novel? I mean, it's both. And then finally it got slotted into collection for reasons. But yeah, but how do you go about choosing, and how did you choose these characters and these subjects?
I actually, you know, thought along very similar lines to what you hinted at. When building this dystopian city, I really wanted to talk about what it is like to experience it from different perspectives. Simply because, like you said, right, all misery is unique to every single character. And look, they're not all miserable. Some of them do find a bit of redemption. But what I wanted to do was be able to reflect a spectrum of experiences within a given city. I didn't want the focus to lie with single character and their, you know, biases and so on and so forth, simply because I felt that there are enough ways in which our evolution as cities or as, you know, the entire world, it impacts every single person in entirely unique ways. And I wanted to demonstrate that by creating characters who would each be engaging with this reality on completely different terms. Everyone's uniquely motivated. Everyone is they all have their own backstory and their own history. And what really compelled me to do this with this book, to sort of break it up and create this sort of like mosaic view of the city, was that the overarching dystopia is based on the need for conformity. And when you superimpose the idea of conformity and a single set of values onto a massive group of individuals, you know, you want to produce little bricks in the wall, but the truth is every single individual is their own person. And to conform in order to succeed or to survive really takes its toll on people. And that's sort of what I wanted to reflect. The cost of conformity or the cost of having to change yourself to meet an external system of values. When I wrote it, I did intend it to be like a very fragmented novel of sorts, but hey, you know, once the book is out there in the world, the author is dead. And so to people who want to read it as a collection, by all means, you know, it's a collection, it's best read in serial order though, because there are links between the stories and it makes better sense when you read it progressively. And to those who see it as a novel, so be it. In my head, it is a novel. And I'm very grateful, you know, that it's on the locus list at all. So wherever it is on that list, it works in either situation.
Yeah, I mean, author is dead and all that, unless you're J.K. Rowling. Vijaya?
So Lavanya, one of the things that I loved about Analog Virtual is that there is this sense in it of, you know, the more things change, the more they stay the same. So it's a world in which a woman can, you know, not go through pregnancy physically. So, you know, technology has evolved to that extent. But the idea that a woman can be child-free is something that still causes quite a bit of outrage. And, you know, especially in this past year, we've seen the world literally divide itself into virtuals and analogs who've, you know, borne the brunt of the lockdown and the economic and social impact and all of that. So it's the world of analog virtual is like a strange world, but with very familiar problems. I wanted to know how you worked on blending that strangeness with the familiar.
Right. Thank you. That is something I wanted to bring through because I feel like we fundamentally do need to make this massive shift in our mind space as a collective, right? Towards more empathy, towards more awareness, and towards more acceptance of different people and what their priorities might be and who they might be as people. And that is something I really wanted to bring into this book. Something that I love about science fiction, to me, the best science fiction is the kind that sort of creates an entirely unsettling environment or a universe, and then sort of extrapolates these really human concerns and puts them in there so that we can reflect upon them without necessarily being bound by reality or by realism, where we don't actually carry historic biases or existent biases into it. We just carry what human beings behave like into it. And I wanted to take these aspects into it. The story you talk about with you know, the woman who still can't choose to not have a baby, right? I wanted to demonstrate that, you know, this a lot of the time we think we are making progress, and we think we are, you know, the words like empowering and enabling, equality of sexes, and so on and so forth. We are not actually addressing a far, far more fundamental problem when it comes to this, which is a basic respect in how people are perceived in the first place, beyond very, very specific functions ascribed to them. And that is something I wanted to try and bring in as much as possible through every single story, this being an example of one of them.
Yes, yes. It was a wonderful story. It really, really, you know, hit the point. And in general, like that different setting, but same problem kind of scenario that you've created, it, you know, really brings through the fact that advanced technology doesn't necessarily mean progress. Because that's the connection we have in our heads, that, you know, a technologically advanced society is a progressive society, but it really isn't, you know, not necessarily.
I mean, technology just makes it easier to enforce things you would want enforced. It just makes it easy.
So it also reminds me of this other interview of yours that I was watching with Oxford Bookstores, where you were taking questions from participants. And one of the questions was about how you link the climate crisis with, you know, going virtual. And your answer was really interesting, because you spoke about how the what the virtual world demands of us is not really in sync with what the natural world demands of us. So I'd like to ask you that same question, how you link the world going virtual with the climate crisis, because it was a really interesting answer that you gave.
Oh, thank you. So the way I view it, right, the virtual world or our experience of it and the way it is being designed right now. And actually, before I start on this, you know, I do want to clarify, technology is not a bad thing. It is a very powerful thing, and it can be used very powerfully as a tool for unification, as a tool for enabling access and creating platforms and so on and so forth. Having said that, currently the way technology is being designed is very, very top down, and it is being designed towards consumerism and enabling consumerism simply because most of the people building our technology they're capitalist powerhouses, right? And what we have been trained to do through technology is to consume and to consume at a very rapid pace. If I want a brand new book, I will order it and I will have it here tomorrow, right? Using technology. If I want pizza for dinner, you know, I'm just going to put it up on Swiggy and it'll be at home in 45 minutes. And we have been trained by the way in which technology has been designed and built to constantly expect instant gratification. And that is very out of sync with how the real world works, so to speak. You know, we're sitting in a little bubble where everything arrives at our doorstep within a day to 5 days. But if you really look at the real world, if we look at going down to, you know, climate change, this is a long-standing pressing issue that needs to be repaired. We need to arrive at solutions. If we look at our relationship to food, in a very natural sense of it, you grow something in your garden, it takes weeks and months to grow. And I love gardening. I love gardening with my mom. I have a little home garden where we grow our own vegetables. It takes a really long time. And then you get this tiny little handful of tomatoes, right? And that's how reality works. But we are being so disconnected from the process of living, which is, you know, everything happens in its own time. We cannot take a lot of things for granted because all our natural elements come into play. I mean, if climate change impacted Swiggy deliveries, I bet everyone would be a lot more proactive about it, right? It's just that climate change impacts, you know, other people's issues that don't really hit us because eventually all our produce is in a supermarket and we don't even have to go to the supermarket anymore. We just get it delivered home. So we are so many degrees away, and we are being honed by these algorithms to continually want that dopamine hit of buying shiny stuff and bringing it home as soon as possible. And I think that is where the real issue lies. Not that these are bad things, you know, I think it has certainly made life more convenient. It has made living faster. But to consume in this manner without having awareness that this is the impact, right? That we are getting into this instant gratification loop. That's where the real problem lies. So I hope that was as effective an answer as the previous one.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. I mean, thank you.
One thing that sort of struck me while I was reading Analog Virtual, and like you said, most of us who live in tier one metro towns and all, I mean, we live in this little bubble, right? And then too, not everyone, all of us who live in a Bangalore or Bombay, because there's like severe inequalities and all of those things. And, you know, it's nice to look at this and say that it's a dystopia. But like I always said, you know, the best SF is a reflection of our times. And, you know, to paraphrase what William Gibson said about the future, if the things in Analog Virtual are dystopian, then, you know, dystopia is already here, is just unevenly distributed.
Yeah, absolutely. Even right now, like you said, you know, we're sitting in Bangalore, and many of us here have these privileges, but just down the road, there are people who don't. They don't enjoy those same privileges. And outside of tier one cities, again, you know, regardless of whether it's tier two, whether it's a small town, there is this uneven distribution of what we believe is very universal access to technology. That's a total myth.
Yeah, I mean, that's an absolute myth, because I went back home to my ancestral home in Udupi. It's a small village, and there sometimes the phone signal just drops for hours. There's no power for days, because obviously Bangalore is more important. You can't have a power cut in Bangalore. So, right. So that's how it goes. And that just drives home the amount of privilege that we have. And you know, the analog, what divides the analogs and the virtual is quote unquote merit. And that's something that the privileged are most often talking about. And that's the dream, right? Okay, we shouldn't make allowances for the poor. We shouldn't have reservations, etc. Because it all comes down to merit. And I read from the book, from the preamble to the Bell Charter on Human Rights. And this is how the Bell Charter on Human Rights goes. Bell Corp declares that civilization is free from discrimination. A universal system of merit determines an individual's worth to society. We are a meritocratic technarchy. We are the future of the human race. So put this power of tech pro billionaires, and this is how it will be. So can you expand a bit on meritocratic technarchy, you know? And why the Ghanta curve? I mean, the bell curve.
Of course, I think it goes back to this, right? This first, the fallacy of merit, of merit as a fair, equal system. It isn't. In order to even be able to access opportunities from which you can be, in quotes, meritorious, you need a certain degree of privilege in the first place, right? Otherwise, it's not that you cannot, but the number of obstacles you need to overcome, it's tremendous. And, you know, I'm sitting here in my position of privilege, something I've occupied for my entire life in many ways. And I'm acutely aware that a lot of other people don't have access in the same terms, right? But having said that, you know, going back to what you said, Shanoi, about debates about let's not have reservations, like, you know, how controversial reservations are. How merit is seen as this one size fits all solution, right? Like it's basically, you know, you put in your hard work, you are self-made. It's as easy as that. It's a point A to B thing. I think that is a pipe dream that's being sold to people. It is a pipe dream that is also consolidated and perpetuated by capitalist systems, where, you know, you look at this this ladder of success, right? The way we are taught, all the way from our schooling onwards, it is work hard, top your class, get into the best university. Fantastic. Top your university, excellent, get the best job. And now work 16 hours a day so that you get that promotion. And once you get that promotion, you get the house, you get the car, you get, you know, these are the dreams that were sold. And in parallel to that, we are, it is almost being established, particularly in corporate spaces, that all of the good things that come your way are only on the basis of your merit. And it is never acknowledged that different people might be differently able to even access an opportunity and convert it on that scale of merit, right? If I am, you know, if I'm, let's say, in a corporate environment and I'm writing for games, as an example, I've done that, and we want to hire a new writer, but the writer who comes in does not have the same pop culture references as us, because they grew up in a very different environment. The corporate world does not want to take the time to bring this person in, help expose them to, okay, you know, if you're writing mafioso stuff, you need to watch Goodfellas, right? Nobody wants to explain that. It's, you have to come in having watched Goodfellas, and that's the bar. So this is a very tech bro space, sort of an issue, where because we want to move faster, we want to be profitable faster, we only want people who are capable of operating at that speed, at that pace, this sort of herd of people with perfect alignment all of the time. And the bell curve is absolutely a reflection of this. It, for those who haven't experienced it before, it is sort of a sorting mechanism where, you know, HR slots you into different percentiles based on your performance. And it is always determined that, you know, there can never be, let's say, more than 20% at the top of the curve or occupying the position of outperformers, for example. And it doesn't matter, you know, if in a group of 100 people, 40 people have done a stellar job, 40 people are not going to make it. It's just going to be 20 people making it to that top 20 percentile. And so on and so forth. So it is a ruthless, extraordinarily competitive system. And I believe that it sort of lends itself to the notion of meritocracy, because, you know, they kind of go hand in hand towards exclusion, as opposed to, I guess, empowerment and equality and working together as a collective.
Yeah, I mean, the full title of the book is Analog, Virtual, and Other Simulations of Your Future. So I don't know whether it's a simulation we're already living in.
That's the hopeful part. That's the hopeful part. The use of simulation.
Yes, hopeful, quote, yes. Unquote. It's like how Samit Basu describes his new book, Chosen Spirits, as anti-dystopia.
Exactly.
Right. It's not dystopia, it's anti-dystopia, because that he says is the best case scenario. So yeah, right. Yeah.
Speaking about, you know, merit and you know, how differences in opportunities are never really taken into consideration when we are talking about merit. The story that probably illustrates that best in Analog Virtual is Etudes. And going by reviews, it seems to be everybody's favorite story. It certainly is one of my favorites. I'd like you to tell us a little bit more about that story itself, you know, and what you were going for with it, what you were hoping that people would take away.
Oh, thank you. So Etudes is a story about a young analog girl She's a teenager. She's been adopted into a virtual family. But because she is an analog, she is under constant monitoring by Belcore and by Belcore systems effectively, where she has to prove her worth, prove that she is worthy of being a virtual citizen. While she's being monitored, she does not have access to a lot of technology, to any technology, in fact. She's the only person in her class who uses books, physical printed books, and who has a journal, because Belcore doesn't trust her with technology, right? And until she proves that she can be a citizen, she will not get access to technology. This really gets in her way, because her dream is to be a virtuoso pianist. And in this reality, as opposed to traditional piano lessons where you learn with, the way we learn, it's not necessarily the way we learn music right now, because that has opened up. But the traditional way to learn, let's say, classical music is here's a book, it's filled with sheet music, read it, play it, practice it, master it, right? But in this world, there is this amazing technology. It's pretty much, directly synced into implants. It has an internal metronome, so you're always keeping perfect rhythm. It gives you direct feedback from your instrument so that, you're playing it dynamically. You're evoking the right emotions and so on. She doesn't have access to this. And that sets her back, because, a technology like this, at least in my version of how music is learned, it really helps you understand music so much faster. And she works in spite of this to pursue that dream. And what I wanted to really address when talking about writing the story was that we actually have a lot of systemic discrimination on a number of grounds. That is very prevalent from a very, very formative age. I do go into that a bit in other stories in my book as well, where, so the character in the story, Nina, she's bullied at school because she's always, in quotes, falling behind, right? And that is systemic discrimination. You start them young, you feed them propaganda young, they'll pick on people for you, they will exclude people for you. At the same time, I did want to talk about, how a lot of the time simply allowing something through policy, for example, an analog child being adopted, that is, that is policy, but without affirmative action backing it, where people are supportive and understanding and capable of, encouraging someone like this. It doesn't really matter. Like you are bringing somebody to the brink of opportunity and then limiting them and cutting them off right there. And that's what I wanted to demonstrate through that story. It exists on many levels for me, simply because it's a story that's very close to my heart as well. Writing it, it was a hard one to write. Because my heart went out to Nina as I was writing her journey. She kind of broke my heart quite a bit. And through the story, I feel like I wanted to talk about how it is not enough to simply allow things, or permission is not enough, and in fact, permission is a pretty obnoxious, like top-down way to do things. It is, you wanted rights, here you go. You asked for it. Now, what are you doing with it, right? That's rubbish. And like I said, it's obnoxious. It's so condescending. What you really need is an entire system that says, okay, here you have some rights and here you have some opportunities, and we are going to help you get across that line. She does have support systems. Her parents and some of her friends are very supportive. But beyond that, the whole world is conspiring against her. And I wanted to talk about the unfairness of that.
Yeah. I mean, the character, she sort of sticks out like a bubble in a still water, and you sort of feel bad because everything is all so uniform and still. And, the other bit that Analog Virtual also sort of highlighted for me is the extremes to which you took what we could possibly call virtue signaling or being performative on social media. It really doesn't matter who you are, what you do, as long as you say the right things and do the right things and, you know, be cool about it and all of that. So, I mean, so a little bit more about that. I mean, whether it was a Bemoji project, whether you like it or not, your things will be out there for everyone to see. It's like that joke, you know, that meme that was doing the rounds where this broker is showing a commode to this prospective buyer and says, hey, here's this commode, that'll post all his shit on Twitter, on Facebook. So the Bemoji reminded me of that. You know, and whether it was, you know, sort of Ophelia that, you know, tries to bring you down into conformity, and the women, you know, whether it is Trishalicious and all of those people trying to, you know, sort of fit in, be cool, and all of those things. So was that a criticism of current social media behavior or certain people, or, you know, or like when people say, hey, here's a controversial opinion, it really isn't, it's just saying that for more, you know, likes, like you said, dopamine hit.
Yeah, it was in part a massive criticism of, you know, the way social media works, where a lot of the time one does not necessarily always mean the things one says. And there is a lot of, let me join the bandwagon because of peer pressure, right? Like what will everybody else on my Facebook or Twitter or Instagram think if I don't comment on this, or if I don't say something about this? That was part of it. The other part of it, this sort of conformity being, soft conformity, right? Like of opinions and values and all of that. It emerged to me as pretty problematic once I realized that most of the time with the people I was hanging out with in real life, we would be sitting at, you know, lunch conversations or dinner conversations, and everybody would have watched the same stuff on, whether it's on YouTube or Netflix, and had the exact same opinions on it. You know, everyone is talking about creating the exact same critiques. There is pretty much no difference of opinion. And that sort of started to really disturb me a little bit, because a lot of the time we need tension, you need differences of opinion to really sort of explore a point of view, to really explore a problem, examine it from all sides, arrive at really critical, well-thought solutions that only come from dissonance, right? And to have this echo chamber of, and you know, it, of course, I'm talking about, you know, really soft terms like pop culture, right? Where there's this echo chamber where everybody's favorite, I don't know, MCU movie is the Black Panther thing, right? And everyone's saying awesome stuff about it. And I'm not taking anything away from the movie. That's not what I'm saying. It just becomes disturbing when nobody has anything critical to say of something that is so popular, and so on and so forth. But when you take that outside the realms of pop culture and kind of, you know, just nudge it a little and look at more pressing concerns, you know, like our social inequality, the disparity of opportunities of technology. And everybody has this, like, you know, like we were saying a little bit earlier, this little bubble where they think, oh, but everyone has access to technology, right? Like, that's awesome. We are so progressive, and the human race is getting better. It's not how it works. But yeah, so that's where I was coming from when I sort of created these perfect alignment pop cultural systems.
Okay. To the people listening in, please feel free to type in your questions to Lavanya in the chat, or if you're on YouTube, in the YouTube chat, and we'll be taking that in a few minutes. So my one last question to you would be, Lavanya, the choice of Bangalore, right? Apart from the fact that you are a Bangalorean and you live in Bangalore and love it and are familiar with it, was beyond that, what was the reason to cast Bangalore, you know, set it in Bangalore? Is that more to it than just familiarity with the city itself? One bit. Second question I wanted to ask is, where is the vegetable farm located? Is it by any chance in Whitefield? or is it not in Whitefield because Apex City is Bangalore and Whitefield is Whitefield?
It could well be in Whitefield. It could be Whitefield. It's just far off, you know, far away enough from the rest of things for it to be a nice closed facility.
Okay, Whitefield then.
Whitefield it is. It's connected by the metro. You can drop in anytime.
But you can never leave.
But you can never leave. Nope. So, of course, Bangalore actually lent itself very, very easily to this book because of its current ethos. And, you know, having lived here, having grown up here, I've seen the city transform, as many Bangaloreans have, from this sort of very laid-back, chill environment to startup central, where you can't walk into a coffee shop without hearing like investor pitches in progress and teams having their, you know, their like daily updates. So that those are happening in every single coffee shop, or at least they were prior to the pandemic. And I felt that transition in Bangalore's ethos, I kind of wanted to push it even further and say, okay, so we're here now. Where will that be a few years from now? Another reason for choosing Bangalore really is it genuinely reminds me in its present privilege bubble. I'm talking about sections of Bangalore that have that, you know, that tech privilege vibe. That really reminds me of the very delusional Bay Area vibe, right? Of these cities that are responsible for all our cutting edge technology inputs in the present day, that are responsible for all our top-down capitalist consumerist technology. It gives me that feeling, especially when I look at a lot of the startups popping up here. You know, they are rooted around these very convenience-driven, very sort of, I would say, buy stuff faster technology. And I felt that Bangalore that way was a great metaphor for any city in the world that is going through this this sort of tech revolution, startup revolution. Because there is a certain degree of, I'm not making this as a sort of a blanket statement, but there is a certain degree of callousness when it comes to the types of technologies being developed, or at least on a large scale. They are entirely, you know, more shopping apps, more furniture stores online, right? And as opposed to more, I would say, socially relevant solutions, convenience technologies that, you know, maybe even enhance simple things like recycling, right? And that's the direction I think a lot of tech heavy cities are going in, and I see Bangalore doing that. So that's why Bangalore.
Thank you, Lavanya. So to kind of come back to the stories themselves a little bit, Shenoy earlier mentioned that the scariest story in the book for him was the monster under the bed. For me, it was a 7-year glitch, and I've still not gotten over that story, because what is Mimesis and why is it in people's heads? Like, why would anyone want to do that?
Yeah, that was a terrifying story to write. Look, I was scared writing both stories, just to be clear. They were not enjoyable stories to write.
Yeah.
The process of writing them, when I wrote my message, I was kind of slumped on the couch for days, because it is a bleak, dark, horrible story. If you haven't read the book yet, my message is an algorithm that communicates directly between the nebula, which is, you know, the future of the cloud. It's where all big data is stored, where trends are observed and so on. It is basically an algorithmic implant inside of your head that communicates information directly to your head from the cloud. And it has access to everything about you. So if you think the Fitbit is a bit creepy, because it tracks your heart rate and your breathing and tells you when you need to de-stress, my message is the Fitbit on steroids. And it actually manipulates you know, your everything from your hormones to your physiology to push your decision-making buttons. And I thought, why would anyone sign up for that? Well, you know, if, again, going back to that that illusion of merit. So a character in the book named Aditi signs up for my message and to test my message. And the reason is very, it goes back to the fallacy of merit. It's a super competitive world. My message will help you be more efficient, more ruthless, more cutthroat. It'll tell you exactly what you need to do to get to the top. And, you know, if you are somebody with ambitions, this is my message is the perfect algorithm for you. When I was writing about my message, I was kind of, you know, riffing off of that, the number of productivity apps that can track everything you're doing and recommend things to you, you know, at the back end. Your Fitbit, which is, you know, a Fitbit is a great useful tool, but it's also pretty creepy in the way that it, you know, it's tracking every step. It recommends when you need to work out and so on. Yet these are invasive, right? And I wanted to push the invasiveness of these, and particularly in the light of productivity and the cost of, you know, being super productive at everything else. That's what I wanted to reflect on with my message.
Yeah, I mean, very successful, because I actually put the book aside for a while after that. I was like, I can't deal.
And more validation for my no Fitbit, no smartwatch life. You know, for a sci-fi fan, I'm a bit of a Luddite that way. But then I completely put that on sci-fi writers like you, such features, and like, no, I am happy being a Luddite. Yes, I shall only read physical books. Thank you very much.
Oh, yes.
Actually, the more
morning.
Yeah, so that's it. The more you read SF, the more you're like, you know, maybe technology, like, it's nice, but let's keep our distance.
Yeah, but I need a tinfoil hat.
I guess we need to be clear when we are using technology and when technology is using us.
Yeah.
Yes.
True. Anyway, to kind of tie the whole discussion together, we've kept on talking throughout, and the thing that we've spoken most about is this need for conformity that technology is encouraging, and the way we are living right now is encouraging. And even in the world of analog virtual, that really comes through, because, you know, you have to have that right thoughts, the right preferences, you have to do the right things. And if you're not, you're like excommunicated from society as an analog and, you know, probably sent to the vegetable farm. But for a real world parallel, the lazy way to kind of look at it would be that it's cancel culture. But, you know, we know it's a little more complicated because no one in real life is actually getting canceled. But I do want to, pick your brain on this in terms of, you know, if technology keeps growing and our lives keep getting less and less private, is this pressure to conform only going to keep growing on us, or is there an alternative?
I think, yes, you're right, right? Like, we are rapidly moving away from privacy being something we can demand or expect, but I think that it really depends upon how we choose to use that technology, and I think that requires like several steps back and a lot of cognizance to sort of think about being able to respect other people's opinions, being able to have dialogue, you know, and you know what you're saying about cancel culture, where if I don't share the exact viewpoint as you do over, let's say, something a bit controversial or meaningful to you, right? There could be a number of reasons for it. Of course, one could be that I am an extremist and I don't respect your opinion. That is problematic, all right? And that is very much my problem. But a lot of the time it comes from a point of view of ignorance, and it is frustrating to deal with ignorance. Yes, it is. But can every individual facilitate dialogue, right? Attempt an explanation, attempt to reach out and meet the other person halfway. I think in that case, you know, it's not so contingent on technology as it is on humanity. Because it's true, right? Like, as technology is going to explode, there's going to come a point where we are all performing all of the time. And by performing, I'm not saying faking it, but we, you know, our lives will no longer necessarily be entirely private. And you know, this is something that I think, as Vidya writes about in Machinehood, I think The Circle by Dave Eggers, you know, they deal with themes of a complete lack of privacy. and that's not a very distant future. It's just, given that, what can we be better human beings? Can we be more empathetic to the different circumstances from which people come? That might, you know, it could very well be that is what limits them when it comes to empathizing with you. So can you reach out? And of course, if conversation is completely unnecessary, you know, not unnecessary, if it is completely unrealistic and your attempts go nowhere, then sure, you know, calling somebody out, that is fine. But it doesn't have to turn into war all of the time, is what I mean.
Right. Thank you so much. I think we'll start taking audience.
Yeah. We will. We did say that this one is going to be a BYOQ, bring your own questions. So there's quite a few of them. The first one comes, Lavanya, from Mad Max 1, who asks, meritocracy is not perfect. What's the alternative?
Ooh, that's a loaded question. I mean, I think meritocracy is definitely not perfect, right? And it is quite a bit of a myth. I think I can't think of, you know, a system-wide word, right? Like a single word. But I do believe that the alternative involves, like we've been talking about, you know, through this discussion, it involves not just saying, hey, this is an equal opportunity world. We're not taking anything away from you. You know, like, now nothing's in your way. When inequality exists as the baseline, that attitude or that approach does not work. So I really believe that I think facilitating equality is really the solution. And I'm not talking about equality by erasing differences, right? In analog virtual, there are no cultural differences. Everything is completely like hegemonized to the pursuit of productivity, right? Like there's culture has been erased effectively, except what Belcourt tells you is culture. I don't mean invalidate cultural differences. I mean acknowledge that people come from different points of privilege and see where you can enable equality so that people have the opportunity to convert whatever opportunities that come their way. It's more meaningful that way.
Thank you, Lavanya. The next question is from Naveen, and he asks, given, I recall that the SF you prefer presents an unequal or unsettling world where people have relatable problems. Are you considering a more escapist or speculative story for your next work?
I wouldn't necessarily call it escapist. It's not dystopian. It's definitely not as bleak as Analog Virtual. I do enjoy escapist science fiction and fantasy as well. Unfortunately, I just don't think I write it yet. So my next book is about the future of food. And while it isn't a bleak and dark future of food, it's not dystopian. There are a lot of real world themes that will hopefully be relatable, that I intend to make relatable in there.
Future of food does sound exciting. Like, I'm looking forward to that.
Thank you.
Sujata, 1972, Sujata asks, okay, I hope that's not a time traveler. Anyway, while technology is driving all aspects of our life and it is welcoming, what about the technology divide being created? What's your say on this?
There is absolutely a technology divide being created. You know, we say everybody has a smartphone, and you know, this whole smartphone proliferation statistic about India that keeps being tossed around. Yes, a lot of people have smartphones, but what is the difference in capability between my, you know, fancy privileged high-end smartphone and someone else's smartphone, right? What can I do with it that somebody else might not be able to do with it? That divide is very real. It's very present right now. And I think, again, the trouble or where it really comes from is that technology is proliferated top-down. It is a capitalist system that is selling technology to us. And until, you know, the means to produce technology are opened up, right? And people are given the opportunity to create their own technology, to create their, to sort of divert technology to solving problems on, let's say, a community basis, whether it's a neighborhood or a family or a city, right? Unless people get those tools, it's always going to be a huge divide. And we will always be at, you know, the mercy of mega corporations and the price points that they set. And so that's what I think about the divide in technology right now.
Lovely. It actually leads to our next question. You've kind of taken a stab at it already now when answering. But I'll still ask you the question, which is that if technology is working on a top to bottom way, what is the way out to reverse that? And the question is from Arun.
Yeah, I like you said, I've sort of gone there. Yes. And I think the way to reverse it is, you know, we are, there is currently, again, experimental technology when it comes to, you know, things like 3D printing, right? Or when it comes to open source platforms where you can code and so on and so forth. Imagine the two going side by side and being opened up to everybody, where everyone has access to, you know, developing their things that meet their own needs. Like if I could 3D print, for example, my own table, right? And right now this is really speculative because I've used 3D printers. I actually custom built toy robots with friends of mine using a 3D printer that we bought together. And it was a painfully slow process, right? So it's still a quite a long way out to think that that's going to be accessible. But could that, you know, be a solution where everybody has access to these, either on a, you know, neighborhood basis, an individual basis? Could everyone also then be empowered to code? Could code become more friendly so that people don't necessarily have to engage too deeply with syntax? Like, can we frame thinking in such a way that people can be more self-sustaining as opposed to dependent on, again, on larger corporations to solve problems for them? And I think, I might be going off on a bit of a tangent, but I think that is massively problematic. The fact that, you know, we are being induced into this dependency where we think, it's solving all of my problems, so it's okay to be dependent, but it's actually hitting us in terms of our own sort of ability to problem solve for ourselves and to chase things down and create them for us.
Thank you for that, Devin. Very well addressed. So moving on now from your role as author of Analog Virtual to you as an SF writer, right? There are a couple of questions for that. One is, Yudhanjay Vijayaratne asks, your thoughts on global SFF publishing and making headway in the conversation as someone who is effectively outside the Anglosphere where most of the discussion happens.
Oh, hey, Yudha. thanks for that question. So it's particularly pertinent. It is an uphill battle, right? Or an uphill journey rather than a battle to be heard, to be heard on a global platform from, you know, all the way in the subcontinent. It's something I'm sure, you know, you guys experienced, I've experienced it. A lot of writers outside of the Anglo-centric spaces of the UK and the United States have experienced this. And I think the crux of the matter really lies in the fact that the United States has dominated science fiction publishing for a very long time. It has established the market. It has established precedents for what will be published, what will appeal to the market. But I think, there is, it has not explored all avenues as of yet in terms of what might appeal to the market. And there is room for risk-taking. So for example, a book set in India, why would anyone outside of India care about it, right? Well, we could say the exact same thing, like why would we care about a book set in the United States, in the near future of the United States? But we do. And I think as the world moves towards being a bit more global, I would possibly hope that publishing as a space moves towards representing more global perspectives. There is a move right now where, a movement of sorts where a lot more own voices authors are being represented and are being encouraged to tell their stories. But it is harder. Geography is still a very solid constraint here, right? Where it's a lot of diaspora or people who no longer live in the subcontinent, or let's say, for example, a South America, right, or an Africa doing this, like the platforms for people who are outside of the Anglophone geography and not just the Anglophone experience are very limited. But I think, we are slowly seeing tiny little breakthroughs. Just the fact that, there were a bunch of short story writers on that Locus Long list who, from the subcontinent, Samit Basu and Gautam Bhatia's books were up there as well. It's a sign that things might be moving towards opening up a bit. And I am optimistic. I'm very optimistic, or I wouldn't be doing this.
Yeah, I mean, thanks to you, Lavanya, and you, Yudha, and Samit and Gautam Bhatia.
Yeah.
I mean, the knocking on the door is getting louder. It's just a matter before those doors come crashing down. I think it's just a matter of time. Things are anything to go by, right?
Yeah, and
norms are happening.
Sorry, quickly adding, like Yudha's book, Salvage Crew, number one on Audible. That's not a small achievement, That's huge. So congratulations. And go on, Shenoy. Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was about to get to. The Salvage Crew is, up the bestseller list. Your book, Gautam Bhatia's book, Samit's book are on the locus list. Shivram Das, Nibedita Sen, and, Ayanadat Sharma, they were all there on the locus list as well. So, like I said in the beginning, this year was the highest representation for Indian writers. And by Indian writers, I mean, South Asian Indian writers still in India publishing from India, right? So let me preface that because if you expand the definition, then we'll be here till the cows come home and explaining why that is. Good sign of things to come. And also the community of one of the big things that America has, which we didn't have till this, it was a sort of community. I mean, there were always readers, but there was no community, no platforms to bring people together. That's there. Right, that whole thing of ghar ki murgi dal barabar is slowly changing. Chosen Spirits was shortlisted for the JCB. Usually it's only just Lit Fic that gets picked. So these are signs of changing times, and I think it's going to change. Yeah,
absolutely. And as much as you writers are doing a wonderful job, and thank you to all of you, I think it also comes back a lot on us readers to keep making noise about these books. To kind of really, just keep talking about them because they're worth talking about. They're awesome books. Thank you so much.
I think that's a really relevant point, Vijay. I mean, we wouldn't be here at all without readers. Nobody would want to publish science fiction out of this part of the world without people reading science fiction from this part of the world. And, everyone tuning in today and listening to our conversation, like, thank you all because you make this possible and that's amazing.
Thank you, Lavanya. Few last questions. One from Mad Max One, who asks, which is your favorite sci-fi book? And another one from 1972, Sujata, who asks, is there any platform for young aspiring write authors and your valuable inputs for them?
Wow, favorite. I'll do the favorite sci-fi book first, because I just have to say it's impossible to pick. It is truly impossible to pick. There are so many unbelievable, wonderful books out there. I can probably mention my favorite sci-fi books from the last year, I suppose. Like, you know, we've mentioned them. We've mentioned all those books already. There's Samit Basu's Chosen Spirits, Gautam Bhatia's The Wall, Yudhanjay Vijayaratne's The Salvage Crew. Fantastic books, all from South Asia, just in the last year alone, right? Which is incredible. Other than that, like influences, or maybe wider influences, a lot of the classics. Ursula Le Guin is possibly one of my biggest influences. She's a marvelous, marvelous writer. Check out her Left Hand of Darkness if you haven't read it already. It's a huge thing. Like William Gibson, Kim Stanley Robinson, I can go on. Octavia Butler, long list. And the second question, I think, which was about aspiring writers, I think in terms of platforms, I'm not clear. Like if we're talking about short story platforms in SFF, there are a ton of them. There's the Mithila Review, which is, you know, in Indian SFF magazine, and they just brought out their 15th issue. So congratulations to them. Really glad to see them back. And there are a ton of magazines, right? The Strange Horizons. Each one has their own niche of things they tend to like to publish. It's not dominant. It's a very subtle. You'll get a vibe for what they like to do, or the kinds of avenues they like to explore by reading them. So it's a pretty complex, like hour-long answer, I think. But I would say, you know, look out for sci-fi magazines if you do write sci-fi. In terms of advice of any sort, I would say the only thing you can do is to persevere and to keep writing. Like it's a hard space to operate out of. It's a very subjective space, which makes it harder. But sort of keeping at it and reading a ton of stuff while you keep at it, and reading stuff from every possible genre. I mean, most of the stuff I read is sci-fi fantasy, but I do read outside of those spaces as well. And if you can stay open to ideas and keep writing and keep persevering, I think that's the best thing you can do if you want to write.